When titans clash, there are always traces that history can't erase. When the underdog Greeks bested the Persians, we were left with Marathon. When the Duke of Wellington crushed Napoleon, to this day we remember Waterloo. And when Cornwallis surrendered at Yorktown, it was the birth of a new republic known as these United States. In the same way, two American juggernauts vied for supremacy in the late 19th century. Only this time the prize wasn't a throne, or land, or even a nation. The spoils? Firearms dominance in a rapidly expanding continent hungry for firepower. The story begins in 1870 with the expiration of Rollin White's patent on the bored through cylinder. Now, any number of companies were chomping at the bit to take advantage of the previously forbidden innovation, not the least of which were Colt, Remington, and surprisingly, Winchester. Winchester was already a powerhouse in the firearms manufacturing game, but it only produced their wildly successful lever-action designs to this point. The availability of the bored-through cylinder patents made the markets a tabula rasa for any and all parties who wanted to enter the market. In a true power move, Winchester hired Charles S. Wells and the alliteratively named William W. Wetmore in 1872. The two men were former Smith & Wesson employees and had plenty of experience working with revolvers and bored-through cylinders. Together, they made the earliest of the Winchester revolvers known as the Wetmore Wells. The plan? Develop an incredible revolver, and then unleash it to an insatiable public at the 1876 Centennial Exposition held that year in Philadelphia. It was to be America's centennial celebration, and the perfect stage for those looking to make a huge splash. Was Colt worried? Not in the least. Their fourth revolver utilizing the White patent, the Single Action Army, had been released 3 years earlier and was enjoying immense success. Between the Peacemaker and Smith & Wesson's No. 3 revolver, which was released in 1870, the major players were already in place. Newcomers wanting a piece of the action or for military contracts would have a steep uphill climb. At this time, the competition between Colt and Winchester was also heating up in the shotgun market, something a bit foreign to both companies. Now, Colt had produced their Model 1878 side-by-side, and Winchester began importing English doubles produced exclusively for them by English gunsmiths. Earlier, they had also hired former Colt and Remington employee Stephen W. Wood, a man who just happened to have a patent on the solid frame revolver and a rapid ejection design. But everything truly came to a boil in May 1882, when Winchester wooed away Colt Armory Superintendent William Mason. That same year, in response, Colt hired prolific inventor Andrew Burgess, who previously worked at Whitney Arms and Marlin, to develop for them a lever-action rifle. Colt also announced plans to pursue a pump-action rifle, which would come to be known, of course, as the Colt Lightning. It was the first response by Colt to all of Winchester's activity, but the message was loud and clear. It was this encroaching onto Winchester territory that allegedly prompted a visit in 1884 from two Winchester representatives who, quote, met with the president of Colt to discuss a new product they had developed and planned to put on the market. Is it likely they brought the 1883 prototype model made by Mason and Wood? Absolutely. However, it was not likely the only revolver showcased that day to dissuade Colt from entering the lever action market. This absolutely incredible revolver, offered by Rock Island Auction Company, was over a decade ahead of its time, and certainly would have put the fear of God into representatives from Colt. Not only did it demonstrate Winchester's ability to manufacture a fine revolver, but also featured Wood's innovative swing-out cylinder and ejector, both devices that would not be seen in a production revolver until Colt's Model 1889 revolver. Wood's swing-out cylinder had unquestionably been on display at the Centennial Exposition. Other impressive facts? Out of the 13 known Winchester revolvers, only four utilized the swing-out cylinder design. In December 1876, Winchester also submitted this very revolver to the U.S. Navy Ordnance Bureau. No pistols were bought by the U.S. Navy, but the Ottoman government did issue a contract for 30,000. To this day, it is unclear how many, if any, were ever delivered. Not only is this revolver beautiful, with over 90% of its original blue and stunning case-hardened colors, It also represents a massive clash between two juggernauts of American industry in the 19th century. It is unquestionably a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity to acquire the rarest of all Winchester arms, a Navy-tested, Centennial Exhibition Winchester Revolver with a swing-out cylinder used to tame a rivalry with an indomitable foe. All epic clashes leave their traces. This is your chance to own one.